Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to All Saints, to our third Heritage Lecture. Tonight, Nick Cowgill will be talking to us about the East Surrey Regiment and their activities in 1917. As I'm sure many of you know, All Saints actually has the memorial chapel for the East Surrey Regiment, so I hope if you haven't seen it before, please do have a look after the talk. It's just down in the corner there. Before we start, as I'm sure you all know, the toilets are behind you. There are some nice signs there, so do feel free to use them at any time. You are welcome. The bar will be open after the talk as well. And please make sure that you have a look at the fantastic display from the Surrey Infantry Museum. Thank you very much.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. The one thing Kate didn't say was, what happens if there's a fire? What signal they will give? Well, I can certainly tell you that the most visible signal of a fire will be me running. Should you see that, please try to keep up. Good evening and welcome to this talk on the East Surrey Regiment in 1917. I chose the title, Now It's Serious, because I wanted to try and suggest what the basis of my talk would be, which is that the British Army, obviously in which we include the East Surrey Regiment, was developing, and 1917 saw a sea change in the way the British Army was conducting itself during the war. And it's this sea change that went on with further developments in 1918 to actually bring the war to a successful conclusion. So what I wanted to do is to look at how the infantry, and in particular the East Surrey Regiment, was changing, how it appeared, how it was constituted. When the regiments were given names in 1881, it was hoped that associating regiments with particular locations, counties, might be an aid to recruitment. In fact, that wasn't particularly realised, simply because prior to 1914, the army was not a career in which you would let your son go. The army was still very much a career in which the lowest of the low went, to which the lowest of the low went. So a regiment like the East Surrey Regiment, yes, it would have a proportion of locals in it, but it would probably also be made up of all sorts of other people from different locations, simply because they would need to make up numbers. And remember that one of the reasons why regiments were created with two battalions, that is two distinct fighting units, is everyone okay if I keep talking about regiments and battalions, or would you like me just to briefly explain? Right. On the continent, a regiment like the 31st Infantry Regiment of Baden-Baden is a fighting unit. It's made up of three battalions, which is made up of four companies, which then has, I think, four platoons. So a regiment actually appears in the line. In Britain, a regiment is a ceremonial, formal institution. The regiment itself never actually serves, but a regiment raises battalions, which are about 1,000 men strong in this period, and the battalions are the ones that serve. The next higher formation from a battalion in the British Army is a brigade. From then it goes up to a division and a corps and an army. That's the basic element. And when the named regiments were put together in 1881, it was intended that each regiment would have two battalions. The idea being that one would serve at home, somewhere around these islands, and its main task there was to recruit men and train them. They would then be sent as drafts to the other battalion, which was in service somewhere in the Empire. So it was the Empire battalions that were constantly kept up to strength by drafts from home. And periodically, the battalions would change places. So, for example, the 2nd Battalion of the East Surreys in 1914 was actually on its way home from South Africa, while the 1st Battalion was stationed in Dublin. That was the basis of why this was created, as well as to try and give locations their own regiment. But with the advent of the Territorial Army in 1908, there was a much more local character, because to the regular battalions, as well as an additional battalion or battalions which were called reserve and existed simply to train men, they were added the territorial battalions, which were made up of volunteers. They would have a much more local character. But the advent of the war in 1914 changed all that, and I will examine this in a few minutes to sort of try and suggest how this might change. But what I wanted to do in terms of 1917 is to look at how the East Surrey Regiment might be perceived, primarily through examination of newspaper articles and things like that. Look at the men, the officers and men who made up the East Surrey Regiment, and see what conclusions we might be able to draw from that. And also to comment on ways in which the infantry itself was changing, just as all the British Army was changing. And it was changing in ways that would actually produce a positive result in 1918. So the first thing I really want to do is to make some comments on how the public might perceive the work of the East Surrey Regiment in 1917 as seen through newspaper reports. And I've basically come up with what I think are three particular strands to this. First is that there was much effort devoted to reporting the raising of funds and the providing of comforts, not only for the regiment itself, but particularly for prisoners of war from the regiment who were in Germany. There was a regular feature in the Surrey Advertiser, for example, where they reported on what the colonel of the depot, a Lieutenant Colonel Treby, had received from people. For example, in January 1917, they report, amongst other things, that a Miss Lovelace of Surbiton donated 3 pairs of mittens and 2 pairs of socks, while the New Malden Parish Church provided £6.04 from its Christmas Day offertory for a comfort fund. So I think that there was a conscious effort to try and show what was being done, not only for the regiment, but also for those unfortunate enough to be prisoners of war in Germany. Secondly, there was a considerable level of reporting on the activities of the local unit, the depot in Kingston, and particularly the band of the depot in Kingston. When I was reading the reports, I came up with an unworthy thought of how did they get, or where did they find the time to practice, because they seemed to be in so much demand. So for example, in February, they were present at the opening of a new military hospital in Hampton Court. In March, they headed a march by various local units to a service at Kingston Parish Church, presumably this church. And in August, they were present at a Red Cross Fete and Sports Day at the Sopwith Aviation Company's Sports Club. So there was a lot of reporting of the presence, making people aware of the presence. Finally, and this is perhaps most important, there were obviously reports of the losses. not just in terms of lists of those killed, wounded, missing, but also in terms of particular stories, and also stories of how it was joy, perhaps someone who was previously listed as missing might be found to be a prisoner of war. That was reported. In addition, they took pride in reporting the successes. As you see from the notes I gave you, the East Surrey Regiment contained two members who received Victoria Crosses during 1917, Sergeant Harry Cater and Corporal E. Foster. There were considerable reports on both these men. In particular, Harry Cater was mentioned in a report as receiving the Croix de Guerre, a French decoration, from the Mayoress of Bristol when he was apparently there. And it seems to me that these were actually adopted as our people, even though Sergeant Cater came from Yarmouth and Corporal Foster actually came from Tooting. So there was much pride, there was much sadness. And I think that what I feel was there is that there was a kind of vicarious wish to share, to allow people to share in the bereavements, to share in the pride, and to share in the fact that this was Kingston's regiment. And so I think that that provides a basis on which we can work forward to look at who were these people that they were reporting on. Sorry, this is where I need to turn over the page. And so I want to talk about the men who constituted the bulk of the serving battalions of the East Surrey Regiment. In the handout you've got, there is a sort of graph which I put together based on some 900 names culled from the Commonwealth War Graves Commission. They are, sadly, of people killed in service in 1917. It's not complete because I took out any whose age wasn't given so that I could actually put together a kind of profile of age and rank to see what it revealed. It's always been my sadness, it's always been sad to me that in some ways when we research the First World War in such local terms, we are always compelled to start with the dead because they are the ones who are so best documented. There are other ways in which you can find information about people who served and survived. For example, I know that Harry Cater survived the war because there were reports of him attending a parade of VC winners in, I think, 1925. So it is possible to see that, but unfortunately, it's always the dead where the first stopping point on any investigation. And so that may provide a little way of looking at some idea of the profile of the people who serve. I mentioned briefly how the regular battalions and the territorial battalions would be made up. It was likely that regulars would be a mixture of people from all over the country, possibly with a heavier leaning of people from the location. Whereas, of course, territorial battalions, being volunteers, would most likely be more local. But as you're well aware, when the war came in 1914, there was a pressing need for more formed units. And so the Corps went out, courtesy of Field Marshal Lord Kitchener, for the volunteers, the first 100,000. And these were formed into what were known as service battalions. If you notice the list of battalions I gave, I've actually given the origin of each battalion together with its name. So we are effectively talking about initially the 7th, 8th and 9th battalions of the East Surrey Regiment, and then later the 12th and 13th battalions. These would obviously have been predominantly local, although I know that a draft of men from Norfolk was actually sent to the 8th battalion to make up numbers. But they weren't in any event like the Powell's battalions of a memory. They weren't recruited primarily from particular locations or particular works. So they were perhaps more diverse than one would find if one looked at the Powell's battalions of the Manchester Regiment or the Liverpool Regiment or particular the East Yorkshire Regiment, the Hull Powells and things like that. So there would be a diversity there, but they would probably contain a fair proportion of people locally who had volunteered. I've got a couple of examples which show some indication of what I'm talking about. As if Frank Walter Dawes, who served with the 1st Battalion, the East Surrey Regiment, in 1914. He died on the 23rd of August 1914. He was the son of Alfred Dawes of 42 Burlington Road, New Malden. And given his age, which was 20, he was most probably a regular soldier. Looking at the territorial battalions, I've got a report that this was on the 24th of February 1917. The two former pupils of Kingston Grammar School, a Frank Gaydon, who was the son of a jeweller in Thames Street, Kingston, and a Conrad Aldridge, whose father lived on Kingston Hill, are both being granted commissions while serving with one of the territorial battalions in India. So I hope that gives some indication that what I'm saying may very well have a basis in reality. But whatever happened in terms of the volunteers, the position was completely overturned in 1916 when, simply because of the need for more and more men, conscription was introduced. And that effectively meant that the sending of drafts from regimental depots to regiments effectively ended. Drafts would be trained by training battalions and sent where needed. So much of the local character of even battalions like the Powell's battalions started to erode. And the profile of the regiment changed, I wouldn't say dramatically, but changed effectively. So you would have both local men and men from elsewhere. Corporal Charles James, who died on the 5th of October 1917, aged 25, his mother lived at 47 Acre Road, Kingston, while Corporal William Schick, also of the 1st Battalion, who died on the 6th of November 1917. His wife lived at 9 Fairfield Place, Kingston. Very much local men. And given their ages, possibly they had been original Kitchener volunteers, although they may very well have been later conscripts. By contrast, Lance Corporal Thomas Crook, who died on the 23rd of July 1917, serving with the 8th Battalion, was the son of Sarah Crook of Park Terrace, Sengerid, Cardiff. And this is particularly, I found this particularly interesting, Lance Sergeant Alexander, or Sandy Turnbull, who was 33 and died on the 3rd of May 1917, again while serving with the 8th Battalion. His parents lived in Kilmarnock, and he left a wife, Florence Amy, who lived in Gorse Hill, Stretford, Manchester. Perhaps appropriate where she lived, because Sandy Turnbull was a professional footballer, and he'd won FA Cup medals playing for Manchester City and Manchester United. So it's perhaps appropriate that his wife lived in Stretford. From the casualty figures, I've tried to do a little bit of extrapolation to try and suggest some idea of who these people were. If you notice, there's actually two 17-year-olds who were definitely too young to volunteer and would not have been conscripted. They were a W.E. Lestrille and an E. Quenza. Both were in slightly more unusual battalions. Lestrille was in the, is recorded as being in the 5th Territorial Battalion, which was the rump of the 1st Territorial Battalion, which would exist effectively training men for other units. So he was died in England. He's buried in the Fulham Palace Cemetery, and he probably effectively lied his way in, as did Mr. Quenza, who was in the 13th Battalion, which was raised locally, one of the last efforts for volunteer recruitment before the introduction of conscription. The battalions were the 12th and 13th were raised by Bermondsey and Wandsworth, respectively, on the initiative of the mayor of each of those boroughs. So again, it's likely that Mr. Quenza lied his way in. But the fact that the majority of the private soldiers who were killed as 18 or 19 simply shows that it was a young man's war. The average age, in fact, was of the people who served was actually around in the 20s. It's declined much more. It was something around 24 in the Second World War, and I think it's gone down now to around about 20. So although they don't necessarily fit the full profile of that, it still shows how much it was a young man's war. Non-commissioned officers, again, it's a young man's war, and it certainly shows that age was perhaps no barrier to advancement if you were good enough. You'll also notice that there were two rather elderly company sergeant majors who died in 1917. Charles Wagner with the 13th and Edward Morris War with the 12th. I have no firm information on either of these two gentlemen, but it's possible that they may have been regular soldiers or reservists who had returned to the colours and were posted to these battalions as a stiffening to provide them with the necessary military expertise. Equally, they could very well have been prominent local men who were elected or appointed to non-commissioned officer rank simply because of their local standing, which was quite common in certainly the earlier Kitchener units. Turning to the officers, I see I'm beginning to exceed my time, so I will be fairly brief now. the main point I want to make about the officers is that while the regular officers came from a particular group, perhaps not wholly landed aristocracy, but certainly landed gentry or ex-military families, there was a much wider divergence by 1917. It would have been very difficult, although not impossible, for a person who joined as a private soldier to achieve officer rank. Although, being the British Army, one managed not only to achieve officer rank, to actually attain the highest appointment in the British Army. And I'm referring to Field Marshal Sir William Robertson, who started out as a private soldier in the 17th Lancers and became a Field Marshal and Chief of the Imperial General Staff from December 1915 to early 1918. And certainly it's true that when the new armies was created, when Kitchener's volunteers were put forth, a lot of ex-public school boys, particularly those who'd gone to officer training corps, were appointed as officers. But by 1916, this had stopped. Conscription effectively ended it. And certainly after 1916, it was very rare for an officer to be appointed who hadn't served time in the ranks. So they were actually appointing people from the ranks, promising people were being identified and were being commissioned. I've got an example actually from New Malden, a Captain Stanley Frank Ayres. He's killed on the 20th November 1917, aged 30. While serving with the 7th Battalion. His parents lived at Queensmead, Thetford Road, New Malden. He had been a clerk in the London County and Westminster Bank, but he'd also been a noted athlete with South London Harriers, so that may have had something to do with his obtaining a commission. But more and more commissions were being given to people from the ranks. And these people were sent off to officer training corps established largely in the colleges of Oxford and Cambridge, where they were effectively made into temporary gentlemen, which didn't mean that they were not only taught how to behave in the mess, but they were taught one essential thing, which is the paternalism that was the great virtue of the British regimental system and which people consider was one of the things that kept it together, that kept the British Army together in the face of adversity during 1914-18. So by 1918, the British Army was becoming a meritocracy. And while these new officers may not necessarily have been true working class, they certainly came from sections of the populace where joining the army had not really been seen to be something that you did. The last thing I want very briefly to do is just to say, well, if these were the people, how were they being occupied? First World War is often seen in British terms as being lions led by donkeys. That phrase was used, I think, initially by Alan Clark, the Conservative MP, in a book he wrote at the beginning of the 60s. He actually later admitted that he made it up. But it was taken on by much of the prevailing ideas during the 60s. But in fact, it says more about the way the 60s viewed authority than the way it appeared. The British Army wasn't that. Yes, there may have been problems with the officers, but they were not all donkeys. And certainly by 1917, they were making a strenuous effort to get rid of them. The officer class was becoming lean and hard and hungry, right from the most junior second lieutenant up to senior officers, the generals. The men weren't weren't lions, and they were not being led to slaughter numbly. I won't say they were truculent, but they were actually fairly clued up. Given that the army included so many more people than it had previously had, and from so diverse a range, I don't think it could be otherwise. Yes, there was probably more deference than we would expect now, but that wasn't unthinking deference. And equally, the British Army itself was actually beginning to look at how best to work this army. Certainly by 1917, the idea that the British infantry simply rose up out of its trenches, walked forward in long lines to be slaughtered was not true. 1917 saw the reorganisation of the basic unit of the army, the infantry platoon of 50 men under a second lieutenant, into a specific form designed to enable it to fight its own battles. Artillery was a brilliant weapon, but it was imprecise. So the emphasis came down on structuring the infantry platoon and teaching the second lieutenants that they had at their disposal specific weapons: the Lewis light machine gun, the rifle grenade, the hand grenade, and the rifle, all formed into specific sections. So the platoon commander had his own little battle group, which he would lead forward, and he would be expected not to simply rely on the artillery. Although remember that the artillery was actually getting much better, and certainly from 1916, the British were making great use of what was called a creeping barrage, in which a barrage of shells would be laid down between the advancing troops and the enemy trenches. And that barrage would advance a certain distance in a certain time, maybe 100 yards every 3 minutes. The idea being that it would keep the defenders down while the attacking infantry closed up behind it. Then when it passed, the defenders would be able to take on the enemy trenches. But they were now being given the weapons and the training to do that. Much is made, particularly by American authors, of the competency of the German stormtrooper. I was astonished when I read a book on the formation and the composition of the German stormtrooper when I compared it with what the British were doing in 1917. Very, very similar indeed. And in fact, the British were ahead of the Germans in issuing light machine guns to their troops. If the Germans had a fault, it was because they didn't extend the stormtrooper concept, because they couldn't, to every unit. The British aim was that every platoon, in every regiment, in every division would operate this way. So we have a change in the men, we have a change in the officers, perhaps not a dramatic change, but an evolution. And we have an evolution of the way in which the infantry went forward. And that, I would urge, finally, ladies and gentlemen, is why it was serious. Why now it's serious. And in conclusion, I'd just like to say thank you very much indeed for listening to me. Sorry I've overrun a little bit. It is my perennial problem. But I hope it has been interesting. I hope it has perhaps put a little bit on the names that you might see in the regimental chapel. So I would urge you to go and spend a couple of minutes in there remembering these people and their sacrifice. I'm assuming I would have a chance for any questions, but otherwise, thank you very much indeed.
very much, Nick. That was a fascinating, fascinating talk. Quite overwhelmed, actually. So much information. Did anybody have any questions?
Stunned silence.
The talk tonight is being filmed, as our other heritage lectures are, and it will be available within a couple of weeks on our website. So if you want to mull over, come back to anything that you've heard this evening, you'll be able to do that. As I said before the talk, please feel free to have a look at the Regimental Chapel and the brilliant display from Surrey Infantry Museum, or grab another drink before you go. But thank you very much, Nick. That was brilliant.
Thank you.